Now, I'll be speaking, as he already mentioned, on high temperature materials for their welding for nuclear, specifically fast breeder reactors and thermal power plants. What I'm going to present to you is about more than a couple of decades work of more than 100 of my colleagues over a period of time. We'll start first with the nuclear part, the India's three-stage nuclear program and its energy potential. As you know, the pressurized heavy water reactors, there are many of them, one in Madras, one in Kakrapara, Kaiga, Narora, Kota, which runs on natural uranium, 0.07% of uranium, which is mined at Jadugud and other places. These runs the pressurized heavy water reactors, and the uranium-238 is converted to plutonium. If we run this stage alone, it will give about 10 gigawatts energy for about 40 years. Now, the plutonium that is extracted by reprocessing the fuel of PHWRs ultimately fuels the plutonium-rich fuel pellets, which are used in the fast breeder reactors. And as I already mentioned, the fast breeder test reactor is running for the last 35 years successfully on campaign mode. And once the PFBI is launched and the series that follows, we will be able to have the potential of having 500 gigawatts for about 100 years. IGCAR has been the main focal point of developing this fast reactor technology, along with BRC and other institutes of the Department of Atomic Energy. Now, in this fast breeder reactor, India's huge thorium resources can be used in the blanket to generate uranium-233. Thorium is a fertile material, uranium-233 is a fissile material. And that will run the uranium-233 fuel advanced heavy water reactors, which BRC is working on a prototype which should be online in a couple of years. We fortunately have this reactor's mini version, the Kalpaka mini reactor, which the photograph which you're seeing, which runs on this uranium-233 fuel. Now, this is the vision of the department from the time of its inception of Dr. Homi Jahangir Bhabha of this three stage, because it's basically designed with the Indian moderate uranium resources and large thorium resources. And the type of reactor technology for the first two stages have already been selected appropriately. Third is also on the way. But as is always in such high-tech areas, where we have technology denials internationally, our focus has been on self-reliance. For Department of Atomic Energy, we have been working on Atmanirbhar Bharat from our inception. And now that the government of India has gone into Atmanirbhar Bharat, we are already part of the story. So going forward, we have this fast breeder test reactor, 40 megawatt thermal reactor, which is running for 35 years, and the prototype fast breeder reactor, 500 megawatt electrical reactor, which will be commissioned very shortly. Now, this reactor runs with these three basic materials, the core structural materials, the fuel plant and hexagonal wrapper, which encases the fuel and has to have certain amount of ductility and strength so that the fuel can be used to extract as much amount of energy from a given fuel. Then the reactor structural materials, which are basically components which operate at up to about 550 degrees. For lower temperatures, we use the non-molybdenum version, the 304 LN. I'll come to the LN subsequently. It's 18 chrome 8 nickel version. And for higher temperatures beyond 427 700 Fahrenheit, we use the 316 LN. And the steam generator uses the modified 9 chrome, which is now used also in thermal power reactors. Now, the core structural materials, the major problem with the core structural materials is that it sees high temperature, yes, creep, but it also sees very intense neutron radiation. Therefore, it leads to a lot of radiation damage, which leads to void swelling in the wrapper, and both void swelling and irradiation creep, along with thermal creep in the fuel cladding. Now, the FBTR, which was set up with the French collaboration initially, the fuel is indigenous, made by BRC. It's a mixed carbide fuel, use 316SS with about 20% cold work with a dislocation density, which tries to reduce the void swelling resistance. For PFBR, which has a slated burn-up of less than 100 gigawatt days per ton, a typical pressurized heavy water reactor has about 10,000 megawatt days per ton, where you use 15 chrome 15 nickel, 2.3 moly titanium added with some silicon phosphorus for alloy D9. With a balanced titanium carbon ratio of 6 to 20% cold work, which is again for void swelling resistance. The titanium improves white cell resistance 3, while the nickel, phosphorus, and silicon. Now, these are phosphorus and silicon are one of the most difficult elements when it comes to welding. We'll discuss that subsequently. It improves, it improves white cell resistance. For further achieving burn-up, we have come up with the improved version by increasing silicon phosphorus, making it a nightmare for us who try to weld it. And we have done that. And subsequently switch over with a 9-chrome steel hexagonal wrapper because of its very low swelling capacity, being a body-centered cubic structure. And finally, go up to about 200 gigawatt days per ton with oxide dispersion strength and steels using a 9-chrome 2-tungsten ITRA stabilized steel, which we'll also discuss how we process and join them. Now, this is a schematic of the prototype fast breeder reactor, where the fuel bundles are sitting somewhere here on top of the grid plate, and you have the primary sodium pump and the intermediate exchanger taking the sodium out and then taking it out to intermediate heat exchanger and then to steam generator. The crux of the of how much we can obtain energy from a given fuel lies on this material, the fuel subassembly, and specifically which cases the fuel pins. This is a pin which is 450 micron thick, which encases the fuel, and our aim is to go up to 200 gigawatt days with the clad tube is being the material which will limit the burn up what we can achieve. Now, just let's run through very quickly. What happens in the material when it's subjected to neutron irradiation? Of course, sometimes we can use ion accelerators and other sources of ion impingement to be able to work on this. But essentially, if you see the void swelling, the percentage volume by volume percent increase, which happens with the displacement per atom, the irradiation, there are the voids which generated the G-phase precipitations which happen, and this ultimately is what we should limit. Now, to improve upon this, we came up with this D9 alloy, and you can distinctly see that the void swelling resistance is sufficiently reduced because of the use of silicon, phosphorus, and iron nickel. And we do basically by ion irradiation using a 1.7 neutron before we put it to the fast breeder test reactor for checking. Now, when we went to alloy D9, we started looking at the amount of titanium carbon ratio and the free model and how much the precipitation and the growth affects. And as Dr. Banerjee was rightly pointing out, it's all physical metallurgy trying to get into a technology using physical metal. This is a very high resolution TM structure of the titanium carbide precipitates and also the voids which develop. And we see that there is a definite enhancement of void swelling resistance or the void formation during when you use to alloy D9. Subsequently, we had to go for still higher versions with a higher percentage of phosphorus and silicon. And we have studied the swelling as a function of temperature, by the peak swelling temperatures. And you can clearly see that the D9i has a much better tolerance to void swelling. And we have used ion accelerators here, the ion radiation using helium and heavy ions. We could clearly establish that an increase in phosphorus and silicon content enhances void swelling. Now, based on this, we worked on the optimum composition, and we have come based on swelling and creep resistance, titanium, phosphorus, silicon has been optimized, and the commercial version has been produced by the nuclear fuel complex at Hyderabad, which is also a unit of the Department of Atomic Energy. Now, coming to welding this material, these alloys have to be welded autogenously. No filler metal can be added. They're fully austenitic. It contains hot crack promoting elements, titanium and phosphorus. We don't have the benefit of using delta ferrite, which you use in austenitic materials. And this alloy D9 is definitely within the susceptible to cracking range. And therefore, we have to play with the welding technique and the alloy that we use for the end plug, when we do the end plug welding, to be able to get a satisfactory weld. And this weld, end plug weld quality is one which will determine the integrity of the weld. So we have used the pulse welding technique and optimized the parameters, and we have found that this is adequate for the pressures that is required out during operation. Now, for this, we'll have to develop welding systems. because you're welding a wall thickness of 4 micron thick across with a dent plug. You have joint fit up issues. Acceptance criteria are very, very stringent as to clear stringent. And we have done pulse width tick, and this is basically the end cap which has to go inside. And then once you weld, these are radiographically qualified. When we started working on this with the improved phosphor, enhanced phosphorus and silicon version, we started getting a lot of defects like sad wall fusion, critter cracks, and ultimately we could optimize the welding parameters to be able to avoid all these defects and get a good quality weld repeatedly. Subsequently, we decided that probably laser would be a much more cleaner technique, and we started developing this along with a film manufacturer at one of the BRC facilities. This is a defective weld when you don't have the laser beam focused properly. We need to focus it on the end plug side so that the molten metal in a millisecond range is able to mix with the high phosphorus sulfur, dilute the phosphorus sulfur, and land up with welds which are defect free. And these are radiographic quality welds. Now, that's the story with metallic materials of the traditional variety. But subsequently, if you need to still go higher, we started with 20% cold work material going into 20% cold work D9. Then into ferritic mounted steels, which we'll use for the wrapper, and then into oxide dispersion stainless steel. The advantage is that if you can burn at 100 gigawatt days per ton, then you will have a doubling time over 30 years. That is, a reactor, if it runs for 30 years, it will produce enough fuel after reprocessing to run one more new reactor. It goes down drastically to one third at about 10 years of doubling time, which means that it breeds much faster, and therefore we have higher amount of plutonium generating. Now, what happens is if we use austenitic stainless steel, this is the top of the pile. In austenitic stainless steel wrapper, you can see some projections coming out, and when we have to handle this, we have to be careful not to to be able to handle it perfectly. But if you do for a ferritic steel, there is no increase in the length due to void swelling. And the ferritic steels have a very low damage volume swelling through and through. But then ferritic steels are body centered cubic. Irradiation, it has a brittle transition between ductility and brittleness, ductility to brittle transition temperature. So this is a nutshell of going from austenite to ferritic to ODS. Now the ODS steel is one where we don't have precipitates which go into solution. These are insoluble precipitates, and therefore the stable precipitates need to be retained throughout the thing, especially even when we do welding. Now, ferritic steels are, as I mentioned, are prone to ductile brittle transition, and due to irradiation, this DBTT temperature shifts to higher temperatures, making it prone for brittleness when even when we handle. But fortunately, the 9-chrome version has the lowest shift in DBDT with respect, and this 9-chrome version is what we are used to using for steam generators, both in nuclear and thermal power plants, and we started working with this. So what we did, this is a work which was worked with, again, across institutes, the ARCI at Hyderabad and the NFC at Hyderabad, along with us, worked making steel powders, yttria powders, and then made it into, after a lot of blending, upset forged, and then bore straightening, and therefore extruded. We are the first ones in the world to produce 4-meter long actual dimension particles. We don't work with strips others which others have worked earlier into 4-meter exact dimension tube, which has been done and tested. And you see the dispersed size, it's about 5 to 10 nanometers. Occasionally coarser particles are there, and but the major problem will be when we weld this oxide particles will not be remain dispersed. They will be non-uniformly, or they will grow, and then we will have issues. And BRC has been working. Okay, before we go to that, then we need to optimize the process entirely to make sure the texture is there and the particle size are optimized. A bit of random texturing is required, and these are again basically using the strengths of physical metallurgy and trying to get the randomized texture by which we process this. And see for the quality of the dispersoids as well, with very high resolution micrographs, and then right? These are nanometer ranges. And then this is 6.6 mm OD, 450 micron thick, 4.2 meter, which has been done repeatedly now. Now, the problem here is welding and two solid-state welding processes we are looking at. And recently, I have information from my colleagues in BRC that using pulse resonance techniques, they have been able to weld the end plug in cold form. Now, this 9-plume version is also a difficult when it's not stainless. Therefore, it dissolves when we go for reprocessing. The next version is to go for 18% chrome, which makes it stainless. But then we miss the gamma loop, and therefore we have issues with respect to the texture, and therefore we have optimized the process parameters, and we have to repeated heat treatment, two-step heat treatment process to get the texture in place and then work for the mechanical properties. And this work is still going on, but we have been able to produce about a meter long tube of the same dimension as before, but we still find there is strong fiber and work is going on here. The corrosion rates are drastically improved, but then we are working at a slightly lower chromium content so that we get the edge of the gamma loop to be able to do some recrystallization during the processing. So this is a nutshell about the core structural. Coming to the reactor structural material, we use 316SS material because of the various advantages of steel. The 316 FBTR has a closer control on composition. You will see in the nuclear industry, we have very strict control on composition. However, the stainless steels are prone to intergranular corrosion in the heat-affected zone, sensitization, and the presence of residual stress during welding because of the intrinsic high expansion coefficient, low conductivity austenitics compared to steels. And therefore, we try to lower the carbon, L, and supplement the carbon loss by adding nitrogen. And therefore, the LN gives us the capability of using the allowable stresses of 316, at the same time have the benefits during welding of 316L or 304L. So essentially, that's what we said. The carbon reduces sensitization probability, and nitrogen content compensates for the loss of strength, and we work at about 0.06 to 0.08, substantially increasing the creep life. Presently, this is the material used for PFBR with a design life of 40 extendable to 60. For the future reactors, we are looking at a design life of 60 extendable to 100. And for that, we have worked with different compositions of nitrogen contents to 0.07 to 0.022. Around 0.15 is the solubility limit of nitrogen in stainless steels. So we looked at the mechanical properties and very important on the weldability behavior. Mechanical property wise, you will see the strengths increase with additional nitrogen. But in case of fatigue, the optimum comes around 0.1412, around that range. And along with that, we find that around 0.14 nitrogen or slightly lower than that is the optimum. But then we needed to check for its creep properties. The creep properties have increased by as much as 10 times, which will give us this life extension possibility of the design stage to 60 years and furthermore. When it comes to weldability, it's really a very, very difficult proposition, welding with high nitrogen steels. We did a series of Gnebel studies with our collaborators in Germany, Stuttgart, and then worked out the nil ductility range and find that the nil ductility range, there is a range between just the melting point to when it gets about 5% ductility at about 0.14 nitrogen. And this we have subsequently confirmed by various strength tests. Based on all these mechanical properties and very importantly from the hot cracking resistance point of view, we chose to go for a 0.14 max nitrogen compared to the 0.0608 we are using now. So this is the optimized composition which you're working at, and we are going into productionization and testing further on this. But then you got the advantage with the base material. What about the weld? We again need to work with the electrode companies. We have a small electrode plant here at IG Karkalpakkam, and with some of the medium sector industries trying to develop this industry for able to manufacture this for us. The major problem with this is we tend to control the composition much narrower than the ASME window. The delta fired content is, as per the specifications, can go up to 10. We restrict it to 3 for hot cracking resistance, 7, so that it does not result in formation of brittle intermetallics during the exposure at high temperature. And therefore, we test it for a minimum toughness of 3 decajoules per centimeter square. We're carefully controlling moly and also the flux compositions of the stick electrodes. This we developed with Indian industry, and the PFBR is made by the Indian manufacturer located close by two companies we have developed. We've got, if you see the specifications, it's sometimes a nightmare for the manufacturer. We're looking at a composition of 0.045 to 0.055 on the weld for the 316 LN plus 0.05, and then with the industry and very narrow ranges on all the specification limits. Also looking at stack detachability with respect to composition flux, basicity of the flux that is used. And we've been able to get both the PFBR version and the nitrogen version to our satisfaction. And therefore, these materials are now used. It is very happy to note that none of the international manufacturers of Europe or Japan who are commercially producing these electrodes have been able to match these properties, especially the toughness at after 750, 100 hours aging. Most of them, almost all of them, have failed on this, except the companies with whom we have worked. So we work on a partnership basis with the industry to make sure that the products are made of producible quality. Coming to steam generators, this 9 chrome 1 moly or grade 91 steel is called T91. They are very commonly used in steam generators, but then they are prone to what is known as stifle cracking in the intercritical zone. I'll come to the phase diagram shortly. We have tried to marry some concepts which have been used in international labs and try to come up with a version which will give resistance to stifle cracking. Now, what really happens is when you do a welding, the heat affected zone, as per the phase diagram, goes into a coarse grain heat affected zone, a fine grain, and an intercritical region, where partial amount of transformation happens when you heat up. And when it retransforms, it doesn't have the optimum carbon concentration. Therefore, this becomes a point where stress concentration can happen, and therefore it may fail. So therefore, premature cracking, then this is a problem which is reported everywhere in the world, and we have to learn to live with it. Some do cutting of the tube before the failure, or some will have to go for improved versions. Now, one way to alleviate the type 4 cracking in the intercritical heat affected zone is to addition of boron, because it produces significant reduction in coarsening kinetics of the M26 carbide precipitates, reduces recovery of dislocations and consequent decrease in the creep rate. We have to balance the nitrogen and the boron content, nitrogen content to be reduced so that brittle boronitrides don't form. On reduction of nitrogen, we land up with MX type of precipitate, so nitrogen content has to be very carefully optimized. I'll come to the numbers later. Once this is optimized, then we can do that. Now, this is a work by NIMS in Japan, where they developed a steel 9 chrome, 3 tungsten, 3 cobalt with some boron. They successfully developed this material, but they did not find a welding consumable for that. So all the benefits that we got of a better, superior base metal got nullified because the failure started happening in the weld zone, instead of the heat affected zone where it should happen, or in the base metal. So therefore, what we did was, we chose this concept and married it to the traditional 9 chrome modified 9 chrome 1 moly steel, and then did a bit of work on how to balance the solution temperatures and tempering. But more importantly, we tried to work on different compositions of boron in the range of 60 to 100 ppm, balancing with nitrogen at 47 to 100 ppm. All these steels that I've been mentioning so far, the experimental heat have been done by Midani Hyderabad, again in India, and then subsequently processed at the NFC Hyderabad, co-located two institutes in Hyderabad, is always a benefit for us. And based on this, if you see the Microsoft Grade 91 steel, this is the boron-free version, this is the boron-added versions. You will see that the tempered landmandite has high dislocation density, and the precipitates are finer in boron steel than in the boron-free steel, which helps in stabilizing the intercritical heat affected zone. And we try to see the benefits across, and you will see that in a boron-added steel, you will have coarser grains compared to the intercritical zone, which leads to strength concentrations in the ICHZ. But then you need to test. You need to test and look for the tensile properties. They match. That's not a big deal. But what really happens is, in the intercritical zone, the boronated version has slightly higher hardness, and this ultimately is going to give us a little advantage, which is very clear from the creep curves. If you look at the creep curves of the boron added versions, they are definitely, and especially the weld joints, the red ones is that of the P91 boron base metal, and the blue one is for the boron added weld joint. We do get definite benefits of extended creep life and failure, not in the intercritical zone, but shifts to the base metal side with optimum composition of about 60 ppm boron and 110 ppm of nitrogen. So whatever really happens is when we use this boron-added steel, instead of the most vulnerable region, the intercritical zone, in the boron-free, we have the failure in the intercritical, whereas in the boron-added, we shift to the weld metal. Now, our next thing is therefore to try and get an appropriate weld metal with same property of the base metal, which we have now successfully done. And the boron-added version of this material will be used for the weld. Therefore, the base fracture location has now shifted far away into the base metal. So this is essentially, if you see that the boron-added version, the creep tests keep much, much longer than non-boron versions of the steel. Based on this, we expect to be able to get longer life out of this nichrome with boron nitrogen optimization. Next, coming to the weld metal, we need to achieve good toughness. And if we see the high toughness in TIG welds, we have to have oxygen less than 20 ppm. Typical weld has over 400 ppm. So we have worked on, again, trying to balance composition nickel and manganese to less than 1.5%, keeping sulfur phosphorus low, and then working in composition domains to be able to make consumables. I will not go into too much details. It stays still under some of the technologies which you have shared with the electrode manufacturers. What I will just show here is this bar chart. This E1, E2, E3, E4 are the best manufacturers of the grade 91 steel electrodes. These are three companies with which we interacted. And our base thing is 45 joules. None of the international manufacturers till date have been able to achieve this toughness because of various optimizations which we shared with our manufacturers. We are reaching a toughness of 59 joules against 45 joules, which is now being used. Now, when we add boron, the creep cavities, again, we started working on whether to weld with stick electrodes, SMAW, or laser welding. And the creep cavities in the intercritical zone is what you're seeing here with the laser. The creep cavities after testing are much lower. And so, therefore, all weld properties after 763 hours of post-weld retreatment matches. Please note here, 3 hours. The ASME specifies 1 hour. We specify a longer heat treatment for achieving higher toughness without losing, with losing strength only marginally. That's all for the nuclear side. I will just switch over to the Indian AUS emission program, which, as Dr. Banerjee was mentioning, we have a MOU between IGCAR, BHL, and NTPC for different key elements where we specialize in. We look after materials development, manufacturing technology development, testing and evaluation, ultimately towards 800 megawatt AUSC plant, which will have substantial reduction in carbon emission and reaching efficiencies of about 48% against about 35 to 39% presently. So what concept we use? We did not want to do a full design of the entire plant. Only the things in pink out here are the ones we wanted to replace. And we had to work with the 304 ACU stainless steel, 617 and 625. These are three materials which we worked. Others are traditional materials. This plant will have a 710 degrees mainstream line reheat line of 710 bar. And the boiler tubes, we decided from the very beginning, we will not make any lab type models. Straight at the industry, developed this, and we are very fortunate to have the Nuclear Fuel Complex with us, who makes stainless steel and nickel based tubes for us, melted at Midani and processed at NFC, exact boiler tubes of as per the ASME and the VDTUV specifications. And for the rotors, developing forgings with one private party as well as with the government, with Midani, and also the castings. Just a moment, my slide again. Okay, fine. Now for 304 HCU, you will see this is the A7 specifically. We have tinkered a bit with the composition. We have worked at a 50 mm to OD tube with 9.5 mm thickness with various specifications, which you could achieve all of them in the Indian tube. In fact, this Indian specific, we had it manufactured also by an European company to match them. And then we started characterizing when we tried to optimize the composition with respect to what happens after 20,000 hours of aging and to see for what precipitates evolve and what it has effects on the properties. After solution annealing, we have also seen for the precipitates which evolve and after 5,000 hours of aging. I will not go into detail for paucity of time. And then looked at creep curves. This is the creep curve. The data in star is the data, and it exactly matches this initially. This is the initial part. Subsequently, we have seen that it is equal to or better than the international data or ASME court case data. It only goes to show that if you hold hand with the Indian industry, we are capable of delivering any material of any quality for advanced materials. Of course, we had to go through a lot of physical metallurgy work trying to look at the creep deformed structures, trying to understand how the dislocations overcome copper and what contributes to its improved strength. Again, after aging and after creeping, we have tested and find out all the details which are there. Some of them in published literature, some of which we can share with them. But then ultimately is the property. We studied LCF and creep fatigue interaction and demonstrated that they are okay with the design requirements that are necessary. Looking at fatigue crack growth and fracture toughness parameters, again, we tried to establish the thresholds and tried to convince ourselves that the life we are projecting for this power plant is adequate and will be helpful for further plant life extension subsequently. But then with copper, we start the same problem. When we start to weld, we will end up with hot cracking. And therefore, we need to optimize the weld metal composition, which we have now successfully developed. We did a series of hot ductility studies in a Gleeble and try to optimize with various compositions and understanding how to control the hot cracking behavior, and therefore and then develop suitable 304H copper stainless steel wires again with one of the Indian manufacturers, and then drawn to wires Midani in this case. Now coming to 617, which will take us to the highest temperature, again we started working with actual dimension tubes, and here we literally played with every alloying element based on our understanding of the materials. And then we tried to produce these tubes. We have thus far produced the longest length, about 9.5 meters length at NFC with this composition domain. And this now has been taken as a version, they call it 617C in the European market, because we also got it manufactured by an European partner. We have looked at all the issues on the tubes, on the ran textures, as well as the homogeneous distribution of carbides, and what are the one limiting factors if we have to get a good process steel. And then looked at aging. We have aged at 10 degree intervals or long durations and studied how the aging of the tubes affects the degradation of the microstructure. And then look into properties, look at the CFI diagrams, look at LCF versus CFI, compared with international data, and here you will see we are above the international data ranges very conclusively. Some data are still going ahead. Now, this is one reason why we got into collaboration with academic institutes and R&D. Three of my collaborators are online, Provas Chakravarti, Rahul Mitra, so Tarafdar, plus a few more institutes. We ran a round-robin testing of all these materials and made sure that lab-to-lab variation data is taken in, and then we get the scatterband and ensure that the product is up to the mark, better than international quality as what we look at. The again, looking at the entire range of fatigue crack growth fracture properties of 617 M tubes, and then trying to work out how reliable is this with respect to the life what we are projecting. But again, nickel base with low fluidity has issues of hot cracks. There's no eutectic for backfilling, and we studied the entire hot cracking susceptibility, looked at the NDR and the NSTs and using a Gleeble, and then finalized the composition. I'll come to that in the welding after this. The other one was to make 617 forgings for the rotor, and we had to get uniform texture and a microstructure through a thickness of 800 mm thick forgings. And we balanced the microstructure. We did enough TM-based studies of microstructural characterization, looked at their mechanical behavior, taking the different regions of the thick forgings. And if you see, this is the tube, and the 800 mm forging is up here. This essentially goes that if we do the right type of analysis up before we pass on the tech specs to the industry, we can achieve the, whatever we are looking for. Again, alloy 65 castings, the biggest casting so far international has been cast by BHEL Haridwar, and we've done entire characterization of the grain sizes of this thick casting, which will go for the casings of the hydropressure turbines. Looked at the coffin mass and strain lives, the creep lives of these castings, and how creep elongation happens at these things, and then try to see that the design parameters are met and give confidence to the designers. Coming to welding, we did welding of the 3048, 617, similar and dissimilar. They passed all the tests that are required, and ultimately, as per the ASME Section 9 requirements, we tested the desired properties, which were acceptable. Looked at the creep behavior of its base metal and the weld joints, that also was within expected domains. But and then looked at for the welding of the dissimilar joint, which had to be welded definitely because we have tubes across two different temperature ranges. And we looked at the creep properties, and you welding with 3048 CU Mark II version, which is a slight modification in the composition, and we have been able to get a good enough life than what we did with the international available 3048 wires. Then vector into welding processes, started working at automated welding fabrications because there were tens of kilometers of this thing. So we shifted in for developing the procedures for orbital TIG welding, and then tried to optimize the parameter, the groove parameters, and then looked at the microstructure. We developed the procedures, handed over to BHEL Tiruchirappalli, who are doing the boiler fabrication, and then will deliver to the plant. Based on these methods, all these tubes are presently in a Dadri power plant as a typical test section. These are the test sections which are being used. They have been running for more than 5,000 hours by now. Test sections have been installed. This is a 210 megawatt electrical boiler. We have done some methodology by which we increase the temperature of this low temperature subcritical power plant to about 700 degrees centigrade. Nobody believed that we could make water wall panels of 9-chrome-1 moly steel, which has not been ever used. BHEL Trichy, along with technological support from us at IGCAR, have been able to demonstrate fabrication of the water walls, including repair wells, which may be required at site. But the major challenge, as even Dr. Banerjee was initially mentioning, was to have a dissimilar rotor, because the 9-chrome steel rotor, which is the traditional one, works up to 580, and we are going to 720. So we needed to develop the welding procedure for that. These are the compositions. I'll skip this. We have used the narrow gap TIG welding machine, which is available at IGCAR with a 400 mm torch for welding this, and wall thickness. And there are issues. So we did the buttering first with that, and then with this is basically 617 composition, tailor made for this work. Did some post-buttering heat treatment, and then we did the welding. This is for the 400 mm. Right now, the 800 mm is just off the block of the machine. We have been able to weld. It's not a full through and through. There's a pocket which is there. You can see here. There's a pocket here, but then we have to make sure that in a closed weld, we are able to do purging at the root level. So in short, I will sum up, and I think I'm just holding time. For the Indian fast breeder reactor, we have developed improved materials for the core structures, the reactor structures, and their matching composition. For the Indian specific version of the AUSC thermal power plant, which is a mission program anchored by the PSS office, and right now with DHI, 3048 CU for the boiler tubes, the forging castings, we developed the procedure and transferred it to BHEL Haridwar and to BHEL Trichy for doing the actual jobs. All properties which are equal or better to the international reported, and also develop non-destructive inspection techniques for the thick section rotors and forgings. Thank you That's all I have to say.